Welcome to this current affairs lecture of Radboud Reflects in cooperation with Vox, Vox Magazine. My name is Dave Willems. I work at Radboud Reflects. I'm a programmer over there. Today we're here because of Trump, you all know that. And what the hell he's doing? Because in the first week in his office, he already wrote 14 executive orders, which isn't that big of an accomplishment, because Obama wrote 13, I read, but it's more about the content of those executive orders. And I've summarized a few. He weakened Obamacare. He stopped funding NGOs related to abortion and birth control. He boosted the construction of two controversial oil pipelines. He started the preparations for building the wall between Mexico and the United States, which was already for part there, but he also boosted this this progress. And last but not least, he executed an immigration stop, which you all read about. Today we're going to discuss what Trump is doing with what he wants with these executive orders. First, we're going to discuss the man behind him, maybe Steve Bannon, what his role is and what an executive order is and what he can accomplish with it. And after that, we're going to zoom out a bit and we're going to discuss if this is a problem for democracy. Or is this a new era of American democracy? The speakers of today are Markha Valenta. She's an Americanist at this university. Tim Houwen is a political philosopher at her university. He's the second speaker. The discussion will be led by Mathijs van der Sande. He's a philosopher at our university and in Leuven. But first, as a tradition, we're going to start with a column of Peter van der Heijden.
The best tweet I read lately was the one on the early morning of the 21st of January. It only read, "What's taking the impeachment so long?" It was even better than my own tweet. The Earth seems to have survived the first day of the Trump presidency. Both tweets can simply have been a bit premature, though. After the first week of the presidency of the pussy grabber in chief, it seems like we are running into troubling times. It takes a special sort of indifference, or better maybe ignorance, or better still stupidity, to close the border for people from seven countries only because they have a faith you don't like on International Holocaust Remembrance Day. Never before have I seen a president sticking up his tiny middle finger to history like Trump, a grandson of an illegal immigrant, did. Earth did survive, I must admit, but I've got a feeling that our planet has indeed changed in the past week. We are rapidly heading into Orwellian times. It's 1984 and Animal Farm combined at this moment. It's Animal Farm because it's clear that all American pigs are created equal, but some, the white Christian American pigs, a bit more equal than others. Did I say a bit more equal? The difference is huge. America now has a president that tries to make his country more safe by keeping people out of seven Muslim countries whose citizens have never ever attacked the United States. But at the same time, lets people in from the countries from which the attackers of the 9/11 attacks originated. Not incidentally, countries where the CEO of the White House Incorporated has enormous financial interests. But of course, that really is a coincidence, since Trump has completely untied himself from his businesses, which are now run by his two sons, or so we are told to believe. And it's 1984 because there is a Ministry of Information now that brings newspeak to the American people, and with them to the world. The truth is something you can either believe in or not in Trump's America. Publishing pictures of the crowds of his and Obama's inaugurations and stating what everyone can see, that Obama's was way bigger, is fake news, according to the Donald and his gang of mouthpieces. Trump keeps insisting that he brought record crowds to Washington. Confronted with the obvious lie, his chief disinformationist, a woman who, born 400 years earlier, would surely be burnt on a witch's stake, oh, could I only have a time machine for her, denies it was a lie. No, it was an alternative fact. Try for a moment to taste those two words in your mouth. Alternative fact. alternative fact. It means that you have a fact and the opposite to that fact, which is also a fact, an alternative fact. The opposite of the truth is also true. It's just an alternative truth. You have the fact that Donald Trump lost the popular vote by 3 million and the alternative fact that he won, if you deduct the millions of illegal votes cast. You have the fact that there was no significant voter fraud and the alternative fact that there was. You have the fact that Mexico isn't going to pay for the wall and the alternative fact that they are because Trump says so. You have the fact that there is global warming and the alternative fact that the Chinese made it up to push America out of the market. And what makes something an alternative fact? The fact, or is it an alternative fact? I start to get confusing myself now. The fact that Donald Trump doesn't want to believe it. Al Gore had his inconvenient truth. Trump has inconvenient facts. And those are fake news made up by the dishonest media. We had some really incredible presidents before. Think Nixon, think George W. Bush. Presidents who were also kind of mad. But there was a system in their madness. With Donald Trump, there is no system in the madness. No, he brings madness to the system. And the dangerous thing is, it's working. His voters didn't care he lied. They believed him anyway. Because they didn't trust the people who told the truth, academics and journalists. In America, the truth is no longer a fact. It's something you believe in or you don't. It's a choice. I always thought mankind would evolve to a higher average intelligence. I thought that was a fact. Wrong. Trump and his voters made clear that the alternative fact, that we are getting more stupid and more short-sighted over time, makes a stronger point. Poor America, poor world, and boy, do I miss Obama.
We will continue the discussion now on Trump with Markha Valenta, Americanist at this university, and Tim Houwen, political philosopher. Markha, I'm going to start with you.
Okay.
President Trump has issued quite a number of executive orders. It's not working. He has issued quite a number of executive orders so far. The first question is, of course, what exactly is an executive order? How does it work? Can these be blocked, repealed, whatever? What is an executive order, exactly?
Right. Okay, so an executive order, an important thing to know is that the president cannot make law. So in the United States, the ones who make the law is the Congress. So an executive order, it has the weight of law, but it is not a law. And essentially what it does is that it tells different agencies that are executing the law, that are carrying out the law, how they should use their funds and their resources. So essentially when you have a law that's been passed, you still have a lot of leeway about, well, how are you going to apply the law? How is it going to be executed? And so what the president does in an executive order is indicate, okay, where should the emphasis be? How should this be done? What should be the policies and the ideas behind what we're doing. On the one hand, you can see it as complementary to the laws that have been passed. Congress passes a law, the president fine-tunes it. On the other hand, what you also often have seen, especially in recent years, is that an executive order, in fact, is a way for a president to take things in a different direction than what Congress had in mind. So Congress often will disagree with the direction of an executive order. And what the Congress has as an option then is that they can pass new legislation as a way of affirming, no, we meant this. An executive order is often, because it doesn't have the force of law, it still has to be implemented. And so that means that, for example, the executive orders that Trump now has been writing, they sound like they're achieving a lot, but very often they don't actually have the means to achieve what they're proclaiming. So, for example, he said, well, we're going to build the wall in between Mexico, but he doesn't say where the funding for that is going to come. Without funding, you can't build a wall. President Obama, his first week, I think, when he was in office, he announced the closing of Guantanamo Bay. By the time he left office 8 years later, it still had not been closed. So these executive orders, they can be quite significant, but they also can actually be quite impotent. And it really depends on what the developments are after that before we actually know what the weight and significance of an order is.
And so, as I understand it, they can also be reviewed by courts. They can be rejected by federal courts in the US.
Right. So you have the check and balance system in the US where the judiciary, so where the Supreme Court, the President, and the Congress check each other. And so in this case, what happened, for example, with his latest executive order regarding refugees and immigrants from those seven countries was that it was reviewed by actually a number of different courts. And then the most well-known one, you had a federal judge, so a national judge, who said, no, this is much too unclear. We don't know who is being impacted. There's a number of other things that need to be taken into account. So we're going to have a hearing later in February. And until then, you cannot implement this executive order. And then what you had was that the Department of Homeland Security, so a national agency, said, well, we are still going to implement it. So we were starting to get conflicts between the judiciary and the executive.
So he has quite a lot of room to kind of ignore the rulings of these courts in this case?
Or he doesn't have the room, but he's making the room.
He's taking it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Fair enough. Then next to the executive orders, he also made another quite controversial decision recently,
yeah,
which was to appoint his chief strategist,
yeah,
as a member of the National Security Council. At the same time, he also told some high people from the military, the Joint Chief of Staff, to only attend the meeting whenever he considered it relevant for them.
Right.
So he basically bypassed them. Why is this so significant? Why is this so controversial?
Right. Okay, so the National Security Council, the important thing is this is the most important advisory body for the president on issues of international relations, international security, and so forth. And so on this council, you have a combination of, on the one hand, you have permanent members who attend every session, and then you have other additional members who attend when invited to the session. By tradition and convention, up until now, the two of the permanent members on that council have been the Joint Chiefs of Staff for the military. So this is the highest military commander in the United States, below the president. The president is the commander in chief, so the very highest commander of the military. Just under him, you have the Joint Chiefs. And in addition to that, also the Director of National Intelligence. So there's 16 different kinds of intelligence agencies or groups in the United States. That is called the intelligence community. At the head of that is the Director of National Intelligence. And those two people have always been permanent members. Now what's happened is that those two members, the highest military and the highest intelligence director, have been taken off the permanent body of the National Security Council. And in their place has been put Steve Bannon, who has no experience in the military, in intelligence, or in any of these political aspects about which this body gives advice. And so he is being put in there on the basis of his relation to the president and on the basis of his ideological vision, which is a vision that Trump clearly wants to have infusing the NSC.
Okay, so this Steve Bannon, it's a name we've heard more often in the past days. Who exactly is this man, and what is his political background?
Right. So Steve Bannon is somebody, he was a naval officer for 7 years, I think. And that's important because that's being used as a validation for having him on the Security Council. So he was a naval officer, I think, in the 1980s. He was a banker for Goldman Sachs. He used the wonderful riches that he gained there also to invest in a show that's before the time of most of you, but from my time, in Seinfeld. And so that was where he made even more income. And then at a certain moment, he met somebody who was the owner who had started up a media platform called Breitbart. At a certain point, he took over Breitbart. And he turned that into a media platform that provided space for white nationalists, for anti-Semites, for anti-Islam positions. And so Breitbart was very important for what gets called the alt-right. Alt-right, you can think of, essentially, you can think of racist, white nationalist whites. And so that site is the one to which he's given a platform. And on the basis of his place there, he also became important as a strategist for Donald Trump. Donald Trump invented a new position in the White House, chief strategist. And so he appointed Steve Bannon there. And now, due to various different kinds of internal politics and developments, the influence and the power of Bannon have been increasing. And so what happens is that now a number of those executive orders, especially the most recent one, really have his fingerprints on it. And I think the most important thing to say about him that you really need to take into account when you're thinking about trying to make sense about what's going on is that Bannon has a sense that we already are at war. And so I think that's very important. And what is that war? That is a war between the West and between Islam, in particular Islamic, jihadi, militant activists and so forth, organizations like ISIS, but also more generally. And if you're operating from that framework, where you have a sense that there already is a war, right, you are going to make very different kinds of decisions than if you think that we're not at war and that, in fact, what we need to prevent is a war.
Okay. So we can already conclude after Reid that Trump is not, an average American president so far. I presume that this is something Trump would also agree with. I turn to you now, Tim, because the Trump has made very clear during his inaugural speech, but also his press secretary has stated several times that this is not simply a president. This is the embodiment, let's say, of the people's will. It's not just the president who wants all these relatively extreme or controversial matters. It's also the people itself that has voted for these kind of policies. At the same time, of course, this people's will seems to be counterposed to, for example, the press and how the press relates to the president, the kind of critical position of the press, the judiciary to some extent. To what extent is Trump, reaching the limit of what we could call legitimately democratic? Mm-hmm. To what extent does this imply a different understanding or perhaps of democracy, or perhaps something that goes beyond democracy or that's not comparable to it?
Well, it depends on your view on democracy, I think. So Trump and also other populists would claim that the people are the supreme authority in lawmaking, and they view the people as a homogeneous unity. And that perspective on democracy runs counter to the idea that the people is always plural and divided, and that democracy should be a governing system that offers room for a plurality of different perspectives and views on the popular will. The populist idea that the people is the supreme authority in lawmaking also means that the check and balances you were talking about are hindrances for the execution of the popular will. So those who are against the will of the people and those who hinder the execution of the will of the people are seen as the enemies of the people, which can imply that the press is seen as the enemy of the people. Academics can be seen as the enemy of the people. You were talking about the Islam. Of course, depending on how you see the people, there are several enemies that can be identified. So there are two contrasting views, I think, on democracy. The one is populist, the other is, let's say, agonistic.
But you would argue it's no less of a, let's say, democratic view of.
Well, I think the populist view on democracy is highly problematic, and that also has to do with that's something that we have not discussed yet, the relationship between the democratic element of our democratic system and the rule of law or the constitutional protection of rights and liberties of our system. If you take the agonistic view on democracy, which means that democracy is about the permanent contestation about the popular will, then you need something like constitutional protection of individual rights and liberties. If you take the populist view, then the protection of individual liberties is something that can hinder the execution of the popular will. So I think there is something. Something problematic. Another problematic aspect, I think, is that the thing you mentioned first, that Trump claims to incarnate the popular will. So if a populist leader claims to incarnate the popular will, then he is just accountable to himself. Whereas, you know, in a, let's say, a non-populist democracy, politicians should be accountable to the people. And that's something, I think, so there's an authoritarian element in the populist ideology. So yes, there is something problematic about it.
So he doesn't require, for example, contestation or debate or exchange of positions in order to be able to play this democratic role.
Right, and that's seen as something illegitimate. So if you hold the view that there's one people who has one single will, then of course there's no need for contestation or deliberation.
Do you see a connection between this particular view, this populist view of democracy in the US at the moment, on the one hand, and let's say emerging populist parties in Europe, I'm thinking of course the PVV, Geert Wilders, Front National, is there like a connection? Are there obvious differences between them? Or
well, I think there's a strong similarity. So some of the aspects that I just mentioned, you can also see them with the Freedom Party or Front National. Although the FPÖ, for example, in Austria, Italy, think of Berlusconi in the past. And what they all share, I think, is the idea that the people are the supreme authority, which also explains why those politicians have an instrumental view on politics. So they just see institutions like parliament or court as, let's say, strategic means. So they value those institutions only if they are valuable for their particular ends. But once they become an hindrance for the fulfillment of their particular ends, then they are regarded as illegitimate. So I see a strong similarity with Trump, for example, in the United States. The difference also, there are of course some differences, and that also has to do with the political system in which populism comes up. So, for example, we have the Dutch elections in March. Well, the Freedom Party will be one of the winners, I suppose, of that election. But we have a proportional system. So that means that Wilders has, of course, a problem to become a ruler in the way that Trump is now.
Okay. When it comes to contestation, when it comes to protest, of course, I mean, whether Trump likes it or not, his policies, his executive orders have been contested quite a bit. There's been a huge women's march right after his inauguration, which probably mobilized more people than the inauguration itself, although according to Trump's alternative facts, that's not the case. But there's also been a lot of demonstrations the past days at airfields, mostly in airports in the US and bigger cities. What do you expect? Will Trump at some point need to take this into account? Will he need to respond to this? Or will this make any will this be of any significance in the short term or longer term?
Yeah, I think there's a number of different aspects. One of them is that Trump seems to have the inclination to continually engage in actions which in the first instance look very serious, but at the same time, if you step back, you see that there's a huge symbolic element. So he engages in a lot of symbolic elements, symbolic politics, and that politics in turn ends up mobilizing people. So what you're now seeing is that many of the people that, for example, during the elections themselves were not particularly mobilized, for example, to vote with great dedication and inspiration for Hillary Clinton, right, now seem to be coming mobilized, and that the forces that are opposing Trump are starting to take on much more clear shape, are starting to consolidate. So I have stories coming out of America, for example, from colleagues and from friends of mine, that since the election of Trump, they're experiencing that, for example, when they go to daycare and they're meeting other parents who haven't ever been interested in politics, those parents are now following politics very closely and are saying, we have to do something. There's groups being set up left and right. People are mobilizing. Universities are giving workshops. So there's a kind of shift from what you were seeing before, for example, during the elections, when people were aghast at what Trump was saying, but you didn't yet really have serious mobilization, to now you have the next step taking place, that there is politicization, that there is mobilization, and that there's consolidation of opposition to him. And that entails networks of many different kinds of groups with many different kinds of interests. I think that's very important. Second thing that we're starting to see going is that there's also lawsuits being brought against him. So the state of Washington, for example, now has initiated the first lawsuit against Donald Trump in regard to the executive order regarding asylum seekers and immigrants from those seven countries. So we're starting to see that the mobilization is being translated into the juridical level. So that's also very important. Another important aspect of mobilization is that it puts pressure on politicians. So we're seeing that, in fact, for example, among the Republicans, there's some resistance to Trump, but there's very actually limited resistance overall. Among Democrats, we're seeing much more resistance, in fact, legislators who are actively participating in the protests, but it also has not yet really gelled and turned into a clear strategy and a clear set of activities. So the mobilizations that we're seeing in the public domain, you know, can put pressure on those politicians to take further and further steps to really actively, within the legislative process, create opposition. So we're in a transition phase, and where it could end up in is that we start getting much more effective resistance to Donald Trump, but we don't know yet if that's going to happen.
Okay, well, we'll have to see about that then.